My name is
it
Calvin.
It is noon on Thursday, folks. Ted Ralston here, downtown Honolulu studios of ThinkTech Hawaii. That was our show, Where the Drone Leads, where we talk about subjects that are relevant to the emerging and useful aspects of drones. We have with us today a guy who's been around Honolulu for a long time in the high-tech area, the venture capital area, entrepreneur area, and he's been escaping being on this show all that time, but we got him today. I'd like to welcome on board today Mr. Vince Kimura. Vince?
Hey, Ted.
Thanks for falling for the bait this time and coming on the
Thanks
show.
For having
finally,
me on the show.
Okay? And the way it works, once you're on, you got to come back. You know, that's how it
Love
works.
Love to.
So you're on here on our show, Where the Drone Leads, and you as the founder, CEO, and original thinker behind a new emerging company called Smart Yields have an interest in drones.
Yes, we
and,
do.
And let's talk a little bit about that. Smart Yields, first of all, and how you got that started and where it's going.
Sure. So, started working.
By the way, we have a drone on the table here.
Okay.
This shows where the drone leads. We have to say, you and I both have to say the word drone once.
Okay.
And then we can talk about whatever we
Sounds
want.
Sounds good. Well, this is a great drone.
Thank you.
This is actually the drone that we met at years
exactly.
ago.
Yes, it is.
Yes,
right.
Yes. You're showcasing this drone. This is your European technology. So.
Yep.
Yeah.
So we said drone about five times, so we got that out of the way. Now let's talk about Smart Yields.
Well, thank you. So Smart Yields is a tool we see to really help small growers, in particular, take the guesswork out of farming. And growers all around the world have a really big issue. You know, one, they're making decisions based on their gut. The second thing is they're using tradition and what they've done in the past and what their grandparents have done, et cetera, as the decision, you know, decision support. So as with any industry, agriculture being the oldest industry in the world, we were kind of questioning, like, why is that the case? Why isn't there more technology and support and money being poured into, you know, food? And really, when you look at the food supply chain, and I don't want to go into the specifics of this because everyone knows it, is that, you know, we have to eat. We have to put food on our table. Food is a national security issue in every country. When you look at the issues affecting the Middle East, for that matter, it's all about, you know, how you can provide that. And, you know, going back to what I call, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of things, is you've got to be able to you know, enable your children and whatnot to have that, to then actually do other things like education, et cetera.
So you're talking about technology and new insights that technology brings forth affecting a really old traditional business, especially here in Hawaii. Right?
Especially
Hawaii,
here in Hawaii.
And we're making the transition from large-scale plantations with sugar and pineapple to a whole different framework of agriculture. So the architecture of agriculture. So you're right in the middle of this transition.
Yeah. And, you know, I think the neat thing about this is the analogy of the technology piece also plays on the food side of things. You know, when you look at the history of the industrialization of agriculture, moving towards mechanized agriculture that we had back in the, you know, 40s, 50s and whatnot, we started to think of food production on a global scale. And what we see today is actually, you know, with logistics, right, with the improvement of data and information, and then it's also our consumer. We ourselves are demanding higher quality, fresher, local, right? So, and we're willing to pay for it. And that's really the big, like, change within this kind of food supply chain. You know, it's weird, and I always bring this up, but, you know, how is it today, you know, there are a billion people starving in the world, but yet there are 2 billion people that are overweight and obese. You know, so really, we actually have a lot of food there, but it's a matter of where that food's grown and where that food ends up.
There's a lot of different factors in this whole game, isn't there? There's also the things that go through my mind. You go to the store and you look at the counter, they got bananas from Chile.
Yes.
Here in Hawaii, which has got to make, Hawaii produces the best bananas around, and yet stuff we buy is from not here.
No.
So somehow the logistics system and the reward structure and the continuity of the quality of the produce, this sort of thing, somehow that slipped away from us here and let the large-scale producers replace that with their stuff supplied from elsewhere.
Yeah.
We're going to try and fix that now.
Oh, yeah.
But you have to get the right solution to go fix that. You have to get the right answer. You have to get something that's appealing to the customer with the right price schedule and such and timing and consistency. So there's a lot of factors here that fit into this optimization equation.
Yeah.
And you're going to go help make that happen.
We're trying.
Who want to join you, right? In fact, how do people get a hold of you, Vince?
Yeah, well, we have our website, obviously, smartyields.com.
Okay, smartyields.com.
And that's probably the best way to reach out to us. You know, we're all on Facebook. We have a very active Facebook feed that our chief marketing officer, Ryan Ozawa, who I call our chief geek.
We know Ryan very well.
So, yeah. You know, he updates that regularly. So, you know, we're constantly looking to try to improve this. And there's a bigger play here besides just, you know, working with farmers too. There's the education piece, right? Mm-hmm. It's how can we empower and make this tool, you know, just as much as you learning how to use Google Docs, you know, today or using iPads and whatnot. You know, students today need to be utilizing data science tools that marry in indoor growing or outdoor growing.
If I can suggest, there's probably also the retail side or the wholesale side of this that has to be adjusted. I don't recall what made me think of it, but I went to one of the large big box suppliers around here and said, how come you guys aren't buying anything local? And the answer was, this is probably 7 years ago or so, the answer was, the quality is variable. The irrigation is by rain and rainfall. It's not consistent, can't be counted on. So material may or may not show up on a given day, and the quality may change from day to day. And the small farmers markets and such, that doesn't seem to bother them much because the customers are okay with that. But in the large retail grocery outlets, it's got to look the same and be the same, be on the same table, same exact amount day after day. So part of what your optimization is going to be on is going to have to be on the issue of that issue of quality and sufficiency and consistency, or re-educate the public to say that's not the thing that you necessarily need to optimize on. Maybe quality is a better thing. Maybe nutrition value is a better thing. So there's a whole lot of stuff, and you're in the middle of all this, which is the interesting part.
Oh, it's great, though.
How did you get started in this, Vince?
Yeah, so I started working with farmers specifically on food safety, you know,
food
pathogen
safety.
Control.
Yeah, okay.
And, you know, our farmers are the you know, they're amazing here. And I think coming from the tech industry, working at, you know, working for some of the big consulting companies and worked for KPMG and whatnot, I got to see a lot of the best practices, and I got to see how really you could have the greatest technology in the world, but if the end user doesn't believe in it or doesn't understand it, it'll never work. And I think working with agriculture specifically has been a humbling experience, and it's been so enjoyable. You know, I've been blessed to have some great mentors in the industry who've really kind of opened my eyes to that. And there's nothing better than rolling up on a farm and chatting with farmers and hopefully finding a solution that can help them using technology. And I would say every single time I walk away, they kind of give you some omiyage, right? Some whatever they have that they've been producing. So greatest people on earth.
That's great. You know, I was at the Agriculture Day at the Capitol back about a couple of months ago, February. And I was walking around there, and I was kind of struck by the inability to readily discern where the center of agricultural thinking was. There was a lot of, the Department of Agriculture had many booths, and the university had many booths, and there was a lot of many booths around, but there wasn't like a place where this is the, you know, the Eiffel Tower of agriculture, the center of it all, the Pentagon of agriculture.
Sure.
And you must be seeing that as well.
Yep.
That they've got quite a distribution. Different islands have different concepts and different things they grow. So optimization, as you're thinking about, and in fact, we need to talk about what Smart Yields is actually going to do, what the product looks like, and how somebody can access it and make it useful to them. You got to deal with all this variation.
Yeah.
And
you know, it's interesting because we just deal with data. That's what we wanted to do. We saw early on that there's a lot of data out there. You know?
The common denominator is data.
Absolutely.
Okay. And you're going to process that data, operate on it, and turn it from data into information.
Yes, we call it insights.
Insights. Yes. Now, no more information. Insights.
No.
Okay.
You know, we learned early on in our process, and you know, when you look at some of the other folks that are trying to do this as well, and you know, I like to say this, especially from a competitive landscape, is that you know, it's a huge market. You know, there's 570 million farmers in the world. You know, in the United States, we have 2.1 million farmers. Hawaii, 7,000 registered farms. But beyond that, too, when you look at the home gardeners or whatnot that are trying to grow, you know, again, this change in this from this global to a regional to an uber-local landscape of food production. And the big thing that we realize is that we need to share information, right? There's a knowledge transfer piece, right? We need to build trust within each other. We need to tackle this food security, food stability issue that you mentioned, you know, on that scale together. And so with all that data that's out there, we want to move all that data together, right? So we want to bridge it in there so now everyone can see that, we can share it, right? So, you know, Farmer Joe and Farmer, you know, Tom next to each other, you know, they can still be at ease, right, with knowing that, hey, we're quote-unquote next to each other, we might be growing the same thing, but we can still utilize the data that would add benefit. And what I mentioned that is, for example, pests, you know, pest tracking. That's a big issue that every farmer deals with around the world. You know, if we start looking at humidity data points, right? We start figuring out what are the factors that cause bugs or beetles or thrips or whatever to move or migrate. And that's the information we need to head them off at the pass.
That's cool. Now, what you're speaking of is a data-rich but insight-oriented extraction scheme of some kind, an illustration scheme, an expression scheme, and optimizations and such. But the way you're describing this, Vince, this isn't limited to Hawaii.
No,
may be a Hawaii product that you're creating, but it's useful anywhere where there's data that can define the process.
Yeah, we've been very, very humbled and lucky. So the government of Hong Kong has actually invested in this as well. So they've created a grant program out of the innovation incubation program they have there to do some proof of concept pilot programs out there. We see Asia and China specifically as a big game changer because a lot of the food production there, China itself has almost 3 million hectares of greenhouse. It's more than anywhere else in the world combined, you know. So it's a combination. It's a really complicated issue. The biggest challenge with small or large farmers is how they can reduce two things. One is their labor costs, and two is their energy usage. You know, and I use energy also to include other inputs. Right.
So those two things, labor cost and energy usage, that's interesting. Those are items you would like to reduce,
yep.
Obviously, and those are somehow related to the product and the quality of the product and the consistency of it and this sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But you focused on things that they can see directly right in front of them, their costs.
Correct.
And that's interesting because that's there's an assumed connection then between the cost reduction, but we're still holding on to the quality here. So at some point in time, increasing the quality or increasing the consistency would be secondary factors that want to be added in here, which could become primary at some point in time.
Yeah, the biggest challenge we have today is there's no cost. Baseline.
There's no baseline.
Baseline, yeah. Okay. So you need to be able to compare that information, you know, with that.
What are we seeing
so
here?
So this is actually our website. So I'm going to announce it today, Ted, because it's on the show, but we are formally launching our basically product. So this is our old website, and next week at the Energy Accelerator Program, the Interactive Week, we're launching our formal. So it's going to be a new website. We'll have a short video. Externally launching
right
our
show.
Beta.
This is coming
yeah,
out, right?
Yeah.
All
we
right.
haven't mentioned anything yet. So this is groundbreaking
okay.
stuff.
All
so
right.
we're going to be launching 2,000 beta users out there. You know,
2,000 in Hawaii, around the country.
Yeah.
No
so
kidding.
We've got a really great mix between education folks. So I don't know if you've noticed, but we actually are working with, you know, the next future growers and scientists and innovators of our time. And that starts, you know, right in the classroom. So the insights and really the simplicity of things, that's what we need to do, right? We need to make something that's easy to use, right?
Application on your cell phone.
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely.
And also something that has lasting value and can adapt to change as time goes on. In fact, when you were talking about this, it looks like that the data analytics are the core of the functionality.
Mm-hmm.
And the sensors can come and go and change. The UAVs, if they're involved, mm-hmm. can come and go and change. The products can come and go and change. But the analytics, it processes all that and looks at the optimization and applies algorithms and such. That's the fixed part that continues on forever. And it's interesting, in this game here of unmanned air systems, drones, which you said mm-hmm. for the sixth time now, that's the same sort of thing. The big picture on the future business here isn't in the drone itself.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the software that does mm-hmm. the analytics. It's in the counter drone, which means yep. preventing somebody from using it wrongly. And the third piece is the analytic products that is produced, and that includes training. So nowhere in there is the unit itself, the thing we focus on,
yeah.
the major part of the future of the economics. And I think you're seeing the same thing over where you
the
are.
The exact same thing. It's so all about education.
Education, and that starts at first grade, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But that's the same thing here. There's a lot of commonality here, basically,
yeah.
in what you're doing and what we're attempting to accomplish here. I think you guys are ahead of us. But let's pick up after the break here. We got to take a 1 minute break. But let's pick up and talk about what somebody will get when they talk to you and how the application will work, what kind of data it takes to make it happen, and what actions they'll take as a result of something coming out of Smart Yields.
Sounds good.
Phone app. Okay, right after our break.
My name is Calvin Griffin, host of Military in Hawaii, which airs here on ThinkTech Hawaii every Friday at 11 a.m. Please join us. We'll be talking about issues concerning our military, veterans community, and other related issues that concern all of us.
Aloha. You can join the Hawaii Farmer Series every Thursday from 4 to 5 on ThinkTech.
And I'm your co-host, Matthew Johnson, here with Justine Espirito.
And we are so thankful to have this show to use as a forum to get to know all the movers and shakers in agriculture in Hawaii. and hear kind of their background in history as well as
Their perspective on what they're doing and also the future for agriculture in Hawaii.
So join us every Thursday. You can tweet in your own comments and suggestions and be a part of the conversation at ThinkTech High. And we hope to see you every single Thursday.
It is Thursday afternoon, folks. Ted Ralston here, hosting the second half of our show, Where the Drone Leads, with a visitor, first timer on this show, but not a last timer. Mr. Vincent Kimura, Vince, of CEO and founder of Smart Yields LLC.
Incorporated.
Inc. Here in Honolulu. And what a fascinating conversation. There's so many dimensions to it we had before the break. It's hard to kind of put your arms around it. It's such an interesting issue you're dealing with. That is the data management leading to optimization of farming from a systems engineering perspective, if you will. So we're going to have a launch next week of your application, which is a cell phone app of some kind that somebody can get a subscription to where they can somehow associate you. What do they do? Once they have this cell phone in their hand with this app loaded, what does the farmer do? Let's take a guy on a 10-acre truck farm somewhere in Waimanalo.
Yeah. No, that's a great question. And you know, I think that was part of the biggest challenge we were building up to in this kind of, you know, new young startup that we have going into 15 months here. And figuring out who the end user is, what their pain points are, and there are a lot of pain points in agriculture. So, you know, as we've evolved through this, and I kind of fondly call this our third iteration, but it's as we've learning, we're figuring out the archetypes, we're figuring out who the end user is. And really it's the gal or the guy on the field, you know, scouting the field. It's the information that they see, hear, touch, smell. That's the information we need to capture. You know, so utilizing hardware sensors or integrating data from drones or satellite imagery, that's just a piece of the picture, right? So it's really the, as we like to call it, the kind of the event management based on the data, why things go up or down, right, or maintain, and the changes of that to then figure out how we can better improve productivity.
But expressed at the level of that person who is sitting out there in the truck at the front with the equipment and the tools and is the one facing the reality. So that person helps you collect information and also then receives back guidance on what to do. Yep. Is that how this all works?
Yeah. So, I mean, it can be anything related to potential risks or factors. And I think that's really been the core around talking to farmers and growers about what do they need. You know, making how to make their day or their operations more efficient and smart, right? So it's not a matter of if, but when things break or we have, you know, borers come in or we have issues or theft or whatnot.
So right now we're issue rich.
We're issue rich.
And solution light,
yes,
right? And
absolutely.
So you're going to go put that together, the cause and effect and that coupling. And then in the middle of that, you must have incredible algorithms that look at humidity and temperature and water content in the soil and nature of the chemical enhancement and such, and the point in the crop growth. All that must be modeled in some ways.
Yeah, I mean, again, you know, I'm not about reinventing the wheel here. You know, we're all about leveraging what's been done, how we can improve it, how we can take other applications, other industries, other technologies from other sectors, and apply that to the, again, the oldest industry in the world. So, you know, we're really grateful to have some really amazing folks on our team. You know,
you just said something that made me think. As we deal with the other applications of drones here, we find that those of us inside the business think that we have to go to the most extreme, exotic answer or analysis or product. But in fact, most people who are not users of, we'll say, drones today are happy with the first level of improvement because it's something they haven't ever seen before. That first level of utility changes their whole function and improves it. They don't have to get all the way to the very end of the... We had an example in the Philippines of looking at a burned-out building after the Yolanda hurricane, or typhoon, and expressed the three-dimensional aspects of that burned-out building so people could figure access and where the debris is and this sort of thing by looking at it. You could fly through it and all this fancy stuff. They said, you know, that's like way too fancy. We just need a picture. We don't need a really complicated analysis which took you 20 minutes to do. Can you just get me a picture? So you're kind of starting at that same point. Just get me a picture. Tell me what I should do next based on this information I've got.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting, you know, from a design thinking perspective, too. It's we always seem to have the answers. And going back to the end user, you know, what do they really want? You know, is
this
actually
a solution? We have an answer to the question we asked,
absolutely,
not the question they asked.
Yeah, what is the right question, right? Yeah. So, you know, the application of drones into agriculture is a no-brainer. We know it. It's the future. It has to be. right? When you look at productivity and labor and serving and information like that, you know, we see it as a huge solution, right? It's not, but it's not just the serving. It's not just the imagery. It's the integration for, you know, for example, fertilizer application or even pesticide application. You know, it's the integration for logistics. And I think that's really the big thing too. You know, we've been chatting with this one company where we're signing basically an MOU with this group called Skylift Global. And they're very innovative folks out of Colorado. And luckily, the CEO is a Thunderbird buddy of mine, MBA program. And they've got a really fascinating drone concept that they've done is they've converted the typical quadcopter idea into more of a helicopter idea. And, you know, they right now today have a 1-to-1 ratio. So a 100-pound drone can lift a 100-pound payload, which is impressive. The kicker,
100 pounds is a lot of payload.
It's a lot, yeah. I'm going to put my kids on there. You know. And you know, we see this application go beyond everything, right? I mean, it's got to be, right? I can see this image where, you know, folks are on the field, you know, on Kauai or whatever, and they're harvesting, and they have an area where the drone comes in. You put the harvest there. It doesn't sit in the hot sun, which is a big issue for food safety, right? And you have it automatically go back and forth. And the kicker on this thing compared to the other drones that are out there is this is purely electric. Right, I mean, you add renewable energy, you know, basically
no fire hazard.
Yeah, there's no fire hazard. You know, it's great. I mean, it's so cheap and expensive to operate.
Well, to me, you know, that's a very interesting point you made about quadcopters versus helicopters versus fixed wing, and that's really something that the industry is going to have to work on from a technology perspective, because this stuff all came either from downscaling manned aircraft, which are typically fixed wing or single rotor helicopters, or came up from the model airplane business, and it just got there. It didn't really optimize its weight, unlike what you're doing in the crop production area. So this is a picture here, of course, of a quad rotor, or some kind of rotor. But the interesting thing is a fixed wing like this is about 5 times more efficient for battery charge than is a rotor-borne system. It just can't be any other way, because rotor-borne is just an expensive way to hold the weight, whereas on a you need a 1-to-1 thrust-to-weight ratio or more on a quadcopter. You need maybe one-fifth of the weight in terms of thrust on something like this. So it's a much more efficient system. You get the wings carrying the load, not the rotor. But you have to launch it and land it in a complicated environment, whereas a helicopter can go straight up and down.
Yep.
What's coming is the world of hybrids, where you have both the functionality of the fixed wing for the long duration and the high performance, and then they convert to a quadcopter or a tricopter, some form of vertical lift for the ascent and the descent. So you can get them into a small place and get them out. So you think of Waimanalo for a minute. We were talking to Vince Kevin the other day. I get people confused here. And Waimanalo is 2,800 acres, more or less, the Ahupua'a, the farmed area. And it must be 100 different people in there, I would think, in that range. So they're all going to have different things. They're all in a little microclimate. Some are up against the Ko'olau, some are closer to the ocean. So there's a lot of variation. Waimanalo is a perfect test place for this functionality. In fact, something like this, either a hybrid or a fixed wing like this, could probably cover Waimanalo in a day. Mm-hmm. In terms of a collection, and then 10 days later do it again, whatever the update rate might be. And then the issues of how the information is used, how you separate information from various people and get the right information to the right guy. You don't want to have my information provided to you necessarily. Yep. So there's a lot of issues of workflow management that come into the picture if we were to think of Waimanalo. It would be a perfect place to think of a controlled test within this, and it's also got some serious wind conditions up against the Ko'olau, a lot of turbulence, and so I think that that's a great place to think of a project of some kind. How do we do that? How do we grab Waimanalo?
You know, it's really got to be this almost public-private partnership. You know, I mean, no matter what you do, especially integration of technology like this, especially with drones or UAVs, you know, you have a lot of folks that are really worried about, you know, someone else looking at the information. So, you know, those parameters that you always kind of set have to be defined. And then I think, you know, going back to the security or the data piece of it, you know, it really is, you can't just show all the data to everyone. No, you can't. So there has to be a third party or whatnot who fits the right mold of showing just the data that they are relevant and appropriate to see. And everything else is kind of grayed off. Yep. But the data needs to be joined and supporting everyone in the community.
For example, if it's a bunchy top banana virus or something like that that blows with the wind, it doesn't make any difference who's got boundaries around their property. No. The bunchy top banana virus goes where the wind
Absolutely.
Takes it to.
Yeah.
And that so there's an example of a shared item
Yes.
that does have proprietary information control aspects because the BBTV could affect one parcel more than the other.
Yeah.
So how would we grab the farmers in Waimanalo all and start thinking about this?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think from my perspective to doing a successful pilot or a proof of concept for that matter for this kind of environment is really you've got to get key stakeholders involved. You've got to bring everyone to the table. You've got to agree to those terms.
Smart Yield is the place they all come together.
Yeah.
Isn't that right?
We'd love to
you
make that
You guys are at the center of all this.
Yeah.
You're the common denominator here.
Yeah.
Okay. That's cool. So that would be a reason for coming together. Whereas if you were dealing with, if you're a fertilizer provider or something, that may be too proprietary and too commercial interested. Yeah. But you're the generalist. You sit on top of all of it, regardless of what the guy grows or where his location is, what his market is. You can attend to what his needs. So Smart Yield at the middle of this. Waimanalo Ahupua'a sharing of some kind, mm-hmm. a poi bowl. Perfect model.
Yeah.
So we get the people. We know the people, right?
Mm-hmm.
We need to maybe the next year spend that time getting it all together and coming up with all the privacy control mm-hmm. issues and all the proprietary information issues, and think of that, and then the public-private partnership working behind it.
Yeah, I agree.
Right? Okay. Wow. We could do that in Waimanalo. And
I think
what a great place to take that leadership.
It's a great area. You know, the farmers there are so passionate. They're amazing individuals, and obviously you're a resident there too. So
yeah,
it's near and dear to
yeah.
your home.
Yeah. So again, once again, people can get a hold of you to talk more about this or to be part of it. This partnership we're speaking of here through your phone number and your website.
Yeah, please, okay. please, you know, send us an email via our website.
There we are.
A message on Facebook, we're on Twitter, so we're on all the social media channels.
Okay, and we got to get you back on the show again as progressively and
yeah,
as
let's
thing
update,
develops.
Let's learn, let's share this information. You know, this is not, you know, we've got to do a darn good job of kind of getting everyone on board.
And you're not alone. I mean, the public safety people are in the same exact situation you are. There's a lot of value, a lot of concern, it's got to be done right, and everybody's got to be part of it. So. You take care of the agricultural optimization, they take care of fire prevention optimization or law enforcement optimization or coastal erosion issues.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it's a very similar process all the way around.
Yeah.
But this one has, the agriculture certainly has something that is daily important to us, the food we eat.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Right here in Hawaii. So Vince Kimura, thanks for coming on the show, man.
Thanks for having me.
Appreciate that
appreciate
very much
it.
What you're doing. And boy, I wish I could keep up with you guys. Okay.